So I will give you actually a brief introduction what this platform is about, and we will focus on the data modeling part. So just quick overview of visualization capabilities of some suite features, but we'll be more focusing on data. So what is Looker? It's a quite new relative to other BI platforms. It was founded just in 2012. And in 2019, it was acquired by Google. And now it is part of Google platform products. It's a software as a service, and it could be on GCP, AWS, and recently they added ability to host it on Azure as well. There is also option to install it on premise, but it's more complicated to support to configure to install. So I will not cover this part. What is different from other BI platforms? It is fully in database platform. So all your actions are run in database. There is no any oven I wouldn't say data engine, but like in Tableau, you can gather different files, data from database, and then Tableau it works using the engine to aggregate this data. Now, here we have just in database. This application is fully web-based, also possible to work on mobile devices. And interesting piece of each BI platform when we evaluate and making consideration what to choose is pricing. But Looker does not publish their pricing. They say that please contact us, and depending on your needs, we will set price for you personally. And from what I saw in network, those clients who publish it, their oven prices for Looker announced to them, price is not low, it's quite high. But it depends on the number of users you will have on your platform and types of licenses these users will need. So they have three types of licenses. It's a just user, then let's call it analyst, and dev. Dev includes development and administration. Here are two slides, but what is most important here to highlight that it works with as it is in database, it works with databases, and it is important to highlight that you should have your data in one database. So each Looker project works with one database connection. You cannot combine data from different databases. So your ETL process need to be organized before you start working in Looker, and you should have all data you need in one database. And also what makes Looker different from other BI platforms, it's a Looker model, Looker data model. It is a mandatory piece of project. You cannot do anything, build any dashboard, any visualization without data model there. So first you need to have all your data in one database, then you need to build model in Looker. And then you can build on top of this model, you can build your oven dashboards, charts, some data-driven events, and so on. I will skip it if you don't mind. So which databases Looker can connect? Actually, the list is quite long, and here I just listed most popular ones. To all slides, I've added links to documentation, and you can check there if your database is in the list. Basically, Looker works with cloud databases, but on-premise also possible with more nuances in connectivity, but actually possible. Interesting and important about Looker that it is Git based. So when you develop your project, your process is versioned, and you can use the same environment even for development and production. You may have separate branch for development and do not deploy to production before you finish your piece of code to do some tests, etc. It's also possible to have different environments for production and development using the same Git repository. On this screen, you can see how it works. So you may, this, they have advanced deployment mode. When it is switched on, you can commit your code to repository without immediate deployment to production. And you can, when working with production environment, you can choose which commit, which branch to deploy to production. So you can move forward with development, do commits, some commit some, merge some versions, but production environment will still be with earlier version. And important to highlight here that in Git repository, only your data model is stored. User-defined dashboards are not part of the project, and they are not part of the Git repository. So when you deploy a new version, you always need to check if how this version works with existing user-defined dashboards. So they have a special button for this, but to validate content. And once you deployed your version to production, you need to run this and fix all the issues it found. And only then let users know that version is ready. And then let's move to the project itself. And here I probably, after this, I will move to our real environment. So project, in project, the main file of the project is a model. And one project may have multiple models, but only one connection to the database. One active connection. Actually, a model could be configured to be able to use different connections. For example, if you have databases, prod database and dev database, different instances, you can set up that your model can connect this connection and this connection. But Actually, it will use only one connection in the moment. You need to set up which one is current. So you can work in dev mode with dev branch. You can work with dev connection. When deployed to production, you can change your, you should change your database connection and deploy this prod connection. Second, very important part are views. They call it views, but in the file types, they are called views, but in all documentations, they call it tables. So let's assume these are synonyms here. Also, the project may include documents, and it's also a very useful piece of project. You can create supporting documents for your project, for your dashboards, and they could be used by end users, not just, it's not document for developer. It's document for end user, and you can reference these documents from the dashboard and give users some instructions or advices how to use it, what is it about, and what to do if something is not as expected. Then another type of dashboard, XML dashboard. So in Looker, you can have two types of dashboards. One is user-defined dashboard. When you with UI tools, you can drag and drop what you need to see, and it will work. Another kind is XML dashboard. Actually, your user-defined dashboard can be converted. You can take XML code from this dashboard and save it as part of this of your project. In this case, it will be versioned as the project, as part of the project. They could be useful also when you do not want to. XML dashboards cannot be scheduled, cannot be, So just specific type of dashboards. Project manifest file, you may have one file for project, and in this project you can specify some constants, you can specify references for to another project. So Looker allows you to import files from another existing project and reuse them. So you do not need to write the code twice. Also possible localizations files and generic XML files, it could be, you can put there what you want. Because actually objects in your model, you may also have, not also, but you will have, it's a mandatory part, explorers. And I prefer to put explorers in separate files. And actually these are generic XML files. And also you may have data tests, data groups definition. You can save them as part of the model file, or you can break them to separate files. And now let's go to the real platform. Serve as a Looker partner has Oven instance. It's a third partner Looker. And that's how it looks. So it's web-based. Let's show you how dashboard can look like. This dashboard uses data sample provided by Looker. It's about e-commerce data. So I'm not showing you our real clients with their data. It's just for educational purposes. So in user-defined dashboard, it contains from pieces. Each break is called a tile, and each tile is just one visualization. Or you may have text tiles, so you may put here some additional comments, some descriptions, some images. These text tiles allows you to use HTML, but with limited capabilities. Plus support GitHub Markdown language. Then, if you are a developer, this develop part will be available for you. And you can see here all projects which are you have permissions to access. My one is this, yes, look at demo. So and here is example of document. And also you may have as many documents as you need. And you also may include navigation. So here here it's just a document, but when you open it in how it will look for end user, I've added here navigation. So here three documents actually linked and you can navigate easily. Your user can easily navigate. About images, also important to highlight, they use only web-based images. So you cannot just drag and drop your image from your PC and it will be shown. No, you need to have these images saved somewhere with public access. Look. And you may organize your files in project into folders. I prefer to have separate folder for data tests, separate for explores, models and views. And documents, I didn't grow. Let's do it. To modify project. So you can see currently I do not have any options to modify to edit because I'm in production mode and it is read only. To go to development mode. It's here. So when you are in dev mode, you have this blue bar indicating that you work with dev mode. And when I go back to my project, I can see now the branch name where I am. Also, it is possible to switch to another branch. Let me try. I do not have any. Let's create one new. Create from master. It will be, for example, shared branch. I want to share work with some other person. Or want to develop some piece of code in a separate branch. So currently I have another branch. You also may have access to another personal branches, but you will have just read-only access without permissions to modify anything. So now I'm in my branch in dev mode. So that's how this document looks in terms of source code. This section is for navigation. It is not visible actually in document itself. This is GitHub Markdown header. This is GitHub Markdown table, and this is XML table, HTML table. And for images, just URL. But let's go to the most important piece of the project. It's a model. In model, you must specify the data connection. Connection specified by name, and all connections are configured in admin panel. Let's go there. So these are all connections existing in this instance. And I'm using Snow Looker. This is default connection provided by Looker. But also there are some BigQuery connections.
Sorry, Tonya, can I ask the question?
Yeah.
If we have two databases, for example, Redshift and MySQL Server, and we want to compare data on our dashboard, on one dashboard, can we combine them?
No.
No way to do it, yeah?
No way.
Okay.
You must have data in one database.
Mm-hmm. Actually, so there first, could be like a few models per project, yeah?
Yes,
and few models, one model can be set up to have one database, and another one will be for other database.
You can set up one model for one database, one for another. But if you need to join data,
so on one report, no, but can. In one dashboard,
in one dashboard, actually, I didn't check, but probably yes.
Yeah, yeah, I've checked it. Yeah, should work.
Okay, thank you.
So if you want just to have one metrics derived from one database, another metric derived from another database, and just put them in the same dashboard, but you do not need to join this data, do some aggregations on joined data, then probably it will work.
But for example, if I want to have one filter for both of them, let's say date filter.
I didn't try.
Okay.
Do you have access to this environment?
No.
That's what was my next question. Who has access to the software partner Looker environment, or how you can get one?
Actually, I guess Sergey Nimchenko is the owner of the environment, and he provided access to me. Probably he is a group lead for Azure and BI part of our community.
Okay, so if I will be curious about getting access or getting an account set up, so I should message him, correct?
Correct. Yeah, mm-hmm. As I know, we do not have any limitations of number on number of users or mm-hmm. licenses, so we can try. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And can you, as I see, Michael also says, can you please type his name in the chat for us?
If I can find my chat, I will go after the meeting. Okay.
Okay. Sounds good. Thank you.
Okay then. Model.
Sorry, Tonya.
Yeah.
After the presentation, the chat will disappear. So you better hurry up.
Okay. Let me try to find where.
Yeah, and your chat probably is in the upper screen, the one where you're sharing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay, we stop it on the model. So model specifies data connection, which files to include in the model, because you may have many files which probably are temporary or your some not finished tests or just POCs, which you finally do not want to show to the user. So just do not include this file and it will be ignored. Also in the model file, we can specify persistent rules. It's a caching and refresh strategy. We will touch it later. You can specify your views and explores right here, but I usually do in separate files and just include them here. And data groups. So all these pieces could be specified in this particular file. Then what else? Models, views. You may have lots of them if your project is big enough and you have lots of data, and probably you may need to do some data transformations before the final explore building. You may have lots of views, and there are several options for naming conventions or grouping them into folder. So first of what I saw that some very basic, very raw views, you have raw prefix. Then when you add something to this view, you just add in refined prefix. And when you have something final, just final prefix. Another way was just call this file as this view called in the table called in the database. And for derived views have a prefix like DT or NDT or SQL. So you should choose your approach and what works better for you. And now let's talk more about views. But before that, I probably will also switch for a moment for explores. What is explore? Explore is a join or just, it could be join or just a view table with some rules about join conditions, relationship, about view labels for end users. Also, you may specify here caching and persistence policy. You may specify a list of fields if you do not need all of them. Also, you can specify here some pre-aggregations. We will touch this later. So each of these pieces, it's a table or view, and we are going there. So we may have four types of tables. Native table, it's just a link to physical table in your database. And this is example. So you specify view name and reference the table name in the database. And you have to describe all the dimensions and measures in this table, which will be used for your explores. Another kind is SQL derived table. So when you specify it just as a physical table reference, you cannot put any where clause here, any group in aggregation. So it's just a reference to table as list. SQL table. Here is example. So we specify this derived table and provide SQL query to select data. And say the same way, we should specify a set of dimensions and measures. It's a descriptive for Looker and how these fields will look for end users. So you any description and title here. So you can change label for the field. You can add description. You can add what else? Some formatting. You may also add references, some drill down references. So if you want that clicking on this field, user has option to move to another site or another dashboard or drill to detailed data for this particular value. So you this should be done here. And Nate, native derived tables. It's also derived, but in another way. This is the example. So to create a native derived table, we need to have existing explore. And based on this explore, we can create a new table with some filters, with some aggregations. We also may add new derived fields to this. So just to explain how it works to show. So here we have a base explore order items and user ID, first order, last order, lifetime orders, bum, bum, bum. How we do create this? I probably will open another window. This explore piece of toolbar will be available for users with analyst role. So basic users just use predefined dashboards. Users with analyst role can have this explore tab and can work with the model building some ad hoc queries and visualizations. So this is my Looker demo. This is our sales. So what we had here, user ID, first order. So take user ID, first order. If this one, first order, then last order, lifetime orders, last order, lifetime orders, it's a measure. So adding fields to your explore, to your query, just clicking them in the left hand side. So then what I mean then? And lifetime gross revenue and return items. Lifetime gross revenue and returned items. So here are the fields I selected. Before running the query, I can check what is the SQL generated. So using my model, Looker generates some SQL. You can check and evaluate how correct it is before running. Then you run it. And they have results. Probably I didn't set up. Oh, what's going on? Let's imagine we see data here, because I suppose when I played yesterday with permissions, I might hide something from myself. So you have some results for explore, and you want to save these results as a derived table. You should go to getLookML and just pick this code and save as a file, and you'll have a derived table. And you can use then this derived table to join to other tables and take this as a part of new explore. So this user orders fact actually is referenced later in the sales explorer here. And then fourth type, but actually it's not a separate type, but persistent derived table. It's a derived table, any SQL or native. Results are saved as a physical table. So when you create a Looker connection to your database, you should have in your database, you should have space for Looker to save temporary data. And this persistent derived table will be saved in your database, not somewhere on the Looker site, no, in yours one. And as a physical database, it may help you improve performance and improve actually users' performance, slowing down interaction time on UI. Not all databases support persistence. So first you need to check in documentation if your database supports, but most of databases do this. And here about explorers again, I mixed. So for explorers, coming back to explore, we have joined views, joined tables here, plus we are specifying filters for I do not have any here. So for explore, you may specify also filtering condition. For example, average lifetime revenue is greater than 1 million. Just for example. What is important here, you can specify filters also in each join part. But you need to be aware that when you query your explorer, the SQL query generated by Looker will depend on the fields you are using in your query. And if you do not use any field, for example, from this last one, distribution center, this table will not be joined in final SQL query. And sometimes it is important to include always include some table. For example, if you have some inner join, which should filter out some data. So you also have option here for this. Always join. So, and you may have you may specify here tables which you always must join, even if no any field from this you selected for query. Also, you may specify here security access levels. It will be later. And what else? Persistent policy. Aggregate, again, it's related, okay. Conditional filters also. If you suppose you explore Mellotron a very, very huge amount of data, and you do not want user to allow user query all of the data, you may specify that user must set up some filters. You can do this in Explore. Plus some UI related features, you may specify labels, regroup your columns. It's more about UI. Then there are lots of links if you are interested in this. Just follow and read details in the Looker documentation. And then we are moving to performance. What we have to investigate our, first of all, we need to evaluate performance, yeah? Find any weak places, and then try to fix it, try to make something better. What Looker recommend for this? First of all, when you run your queries, check generated SQL. Also, they have SQL runner built in into Tableau platform, so you do not have to go to your database client and run something there. You may do this right here in Looker. So I can open it in SQL Runner. I have my connection. I can see tables which are there, and I can play with this query here. There was also a button to explain in SQL Runner. So in this case, it just adds explain, and you will see explanation how your query is run, and you may take some actions for improvement based on this explanation. Also, Looker suggests when you create your Explore, move from the most granular item, the table, to all others. So you should place most granular data first. And they promise that in most cases, this gives better performance. But you should check in each case individually. Also, they do not recommend to start performance optimization with persistent tables. So first of all, when you develop, when you're building your model, avoid persistence while building. Then check all your code, all the queries generated for your explorers, and then try to optimize. Sometimes probably you may set up a correct relationship. You have to set up probably somewhere correct primary keys. So reorder joins in your table. So try these options, and only then, if this doesn't significantly help, move into a persistent tables direction. Also, it's a term called aggregation awareness. If you know that you have Explore, but most dashboards, users will work with some metric which is aggregated for some dimension. And you know this, this combination is used often by many users in many dashboards, just probably with different filters or something else. You may have these calculations pre-built for you, just to not redo calculations each time. And this is about that. So to your Explore, you can add this piece of code, aggregate table, and it will be saved as, so you have dimensions and you have measures here. This will be saved as persistent table, and you need to specify a trigger for this table rebuild. When you are in Explore, for example, I want no brands. I know orders found, and I want total gross revenue. And I know this information aggregated in this way. User temporarily locked. Nice. Okay, so you know that this combination, this pre-aggregation is used often. So to create that aggregate awareness, again, get LookML, and here you have code for this aggregation piece. And also it could be saved as a separate file or added to the Explore right after definition, joins definition. You can see there is a plus. It's a looker called refinement. So you may have different pieces of the same object, of the same Explore in several files. And adding this plus, it means it's a refinement for existing object. Then, depending on the database you are using, Looker may support indexes, Looker may support sort keys for persistent tables, Looker may support partitioning, and Looker may support native materialized views. So you can create some persistent table and just add, I know for BigQuery it works, just add materialization, yes, and it will be created in BigQuery as materialized view. And it will be BigQuery duty to refresh in time this materialized view according to a data refresh in the source table. And also Looker supports incremental PDTs. So when new pieces of data just appended to existing PDT, it is not rebuilt you do not rebuild entire table, just appending new pieces of data. So for example, if there are some daily sales statistics aggregated, you may just append each day and do not rebuild the table for entire table when new orders come to your database. Okay. Then very interesting about caching and refresh strategy. So as I said, Looker is in database platform, and each your query, each your run, it's a query to database. And imagine you have thousands of users, and each user runs Avant dashboard, they use the same dashboard. It's a better case. So the same query is run against database many times. Looker avoids this with their caching policy. Let's go to the next slide and then move back. So when user open Looker, what is the flow? Authorization, then go to the dashboard or look if you are just a simple user. This dashboard based on the visualization configuration generates SQL query to the database. And then here is a stage, queries cache. If Looker already have results for this query, it will return this result to user without going to database. If there is no cache, then your query will go to the database. And here it is important to make sure a user always have accurate data. They don't use stale data during the whole weeks. So your cache should be cleared regularly and according some rules, according to the best way when this cache is cleared, when your new data comes to your database. And for this caching strategy, Looker has data groups. Let's switch. Data group is a definition of here it is. It's a combination of max cache age and or SQL trigger. So max cache age means how long query cache will be kept on Looker side. Default is, as I remember, 1 hour. But if your database is refreshed more frequently, it is not suitable for you. If your database is refreshed just once a day, also 1 hour is not suitable for you, and you should change this value. SQL trigger may trigger clearing cache on some event. So for example, I'm checking the maximum ID from ETL log in this example. And if value changed, then cache will be cleared. What is important here to highlight that cache could be cleared manually by users. And you cannot be sure. So for example, if you set here 24 hours, you cannot be sure that every day at 1 a.m. your cache will be cleared. No, because during the day, some of the users may click this button, clear cache and refresh. And cache will be forced for clearance. And then when query run again, a new cache created, it will live another 24 hours and next refresh will be not at 1 a.m. And for these cases, it's better to use a combination of max cache age and SQL trigger. So even if this 24 hours not gone yet, but new data came with ETL, cache will be cleared. Okay. And it's about clearing cache. Another case are persistent tables, which also need to be refreshed according to some rules or rules. With persistent tables, if you specify that cache, just max cache age, what does it mean? This table will be created when first user comes and query data from this table. Before that, this table does not exist. So when user created, initiated this table creation, it will live for specified period and then it will be dropped and recreated only when next user come and request data from this table. Another behavior when you use SQL trigger. In this case, table will be rebuilt on this trigger. And when user come and ask for data, this table will already ready for queries and will give you better performance if data is huge. And with in the admin panel, they have special section for persistence monitoring. So you have all PDTs listed here and statistics when it was last refreshed, when it was last checked, if there is any SQL trigger. I'm interested only in my connections. No. Booker. Okay, let's try it this way. So here you have, we can see that sessions web analytics, it is not built. It has persist for 24 hours. So it means that last 24 hours, nobody requested data from this table and it is not built. Trigger, when you specify some trigger for your data goal, Looker will check the value every 5 minutes. This is default value. So do not expect that once you upload a new piece of data and the same second it appears in dashboard. No, Looker checks this values every 5 minutes. And this is a configurable option. You can set up it, but this value is common for the whole instance. You cannot set up 5 minutes for one project and 10 minutes for another project. This is instance-wide configurable value. Okay. So cache data for specified periods, max cache age, then cache data on trigger, rebuild PDTs on trigger, manual clear cache I have shown you, and also persistent driver tables also could be rebuilt manually, but only by developers. Generic users and analysts do not have such option. And also interesting case with cascading PDTs and data groups. When you have many tables in your model, in your project, and some of them are persistent derived tables, and some other tables, one table may refer other table, and you can build one persistent derived table and another on top of it, and then another on top of it, so using previous ones. And when you refresh your data, planning your caching strategy and refresh, it is important to use data groups because when all these tables link it to one data group, Looker defines which table should be refreshed first, and do these refreshes in a proper order sequence. So with data group, you can be sure that cascading PDTs will be refreshed accurately. Because you can specify without data group, you can just specify exactly that max cache age is 24 hours for explore for all. For persistent table without data group linkage. And it will work also, but not in cascading case. Any question here? Okay. A little bit about visualization. I supposed to show you, but with that locked count, I'm not sure. Let's try again. Let's try something else. Let's exit from development mode. Let's take product name. Let's filter it by brand. Let's see how many users purchased this product. And too much. It's too much to visualize, but have something else. No, okay, let's start here. So you just, when your query result is ready, you can see, you can verify your data and you are okay with it. You are ready to visualize. So just expand this visualization section and try to choose which visualization fits better for your case. We have here just table or bar chart, column or horizontal. We have scatter plot, we have line chart, area chart, pie, we may have map, we may have single value. Single value actually a very common type of chart for different KPIs. And also there are some, another one, plus custom visualizations also supported. So how you can visualize data? Just ad hoc explore and visualize here. Without saving this explore, this results, you can share it with any person in your team. You may have just share. So you may have this expanded URL, which contains all this query and visualization configuration. It's part of this URL, and just send to another person and he will see the same visualization as you without saving it in a platform. You can save results as a look. Look is a just what just a one visualization with filters, with parameters probably. Yeah. So it's what you have here, just save it. Save as a look. Look. Save and view look. So, and after saving, it becomes a looker part, which available for other users. Save it somewhere in the folder, and you can set up permissions for access. You can then reuse this look for dashboards. So it's it.
Sorry for interruption, but this look and dashboard we can't save into version control, right?
Right, exactly.
Is there the other way if I want to roll back my changes that we can track it?
If you are a developer and you have access to your project, you can modify it. So when you finish your building your dashboard, actually this is look, this is not dashboard. Let's add this to the some dashboard. Save to dashboard. Let's take a new one. And where are we on? New temp dash. Okay. When saving to dashboard, you may have two options, add look to dashboard and save to dashboard. When you save to dashboard, content of this look will be added to dashboard. When you add look to dashboard, it means that reference to existing look will be added to the dashboard. And if you modify this look, changes will be applied to dashboard as well. But Looker doesn't like adding looks as a reference. They have there are some nuances with scheduled updates. So let's use save to dashboard. And here we go to this dash, just one tile here. Let's go to edit. Let's add some text. So now we have two. Let's imagine it's our header. Let's imagine we are using here. Edit. We use GitHub Markdown here. So adding just this symbol makes it like a title. Save. And to add this to your project and get it versioned, you can copy to clipboard. Switch on the mode. Just add this code here and it will be saved in Git together with your project. And you can revert then it to user defined dashboard.
Okay, so actually we can copy paste code for dashboard, but we should do it manually and then we can save it to GitHub.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
User-defined dashboards, they can be created by users, analysts who do not have access, development access to modify your project. Mm-hmm. That's why user-defined dashboards are out of project. But if you, as developer, prepare some pre-built dashboard for them, and they accidentally broken something in the dashboard and then come to you, please help. You can revert the changes from from the version saved in the project.
Great. Yes, I see. Thank you.
Okay. So looks, dashboards, they're saved in folders. And folders, in Looker, there are two types of folders. Each user has other personal folder, like we have my documents in Windows for each user, separate one, similar way in Looker. And they have shared folders. So when you explore, my folder, this is my personal folder. And shared folders, in shared folders, there are folders where you can give access to other users as well. But actually to your personal folder, you may also provide access for your teammates. And types of access in Looker, only two types. Edit and manage permissions, it's one type, and just read only, it's a second type. There is no separate role just for editing, and for manage permission, it's combined role. One more interesting piece is our boards. We are running out of time. Board is a combination of, it's a set of sections And each section is a set of pinned items. So it's just a reference to looks or dashboards saved somewhere. And this board, I have my oven just for me. I collected here my most used dashboards and case studies. Section for each section, you may have description here. Here you can have dashboards, looks, and also added recently, you may have here links, URLs. So you may have section with useful links, which will redirect you to something specific for the for your team. So this board can be shared, but you need to remember that even if you add a dashboard here on the board, it doesn't mean that all your, and this board is in your dashboard is in your personal folder. When you share this board to your teammates, doesn't mean that they will automatically get access to your personal folder. So you need additionally make sure that users have access to folders where these dashboards are stored. We have so many to cover. Guys, I will skip it because it's probably so. Okay, not skip. Drill downs. When user opens something, as for example here, clicking on some metrics or on some value allows you to configure drill down options. And this is fully configurable and managed in LookML project, not in the visualization. Links goes probably together with drill downs. You can configure external links, not just drill to details. You can create link to another dashboard, another site, and also pass some parameters to this URL. Actions is very interesting piece of Looker. Looker supports the idea is to make actionable dashboard. So when you see something very interesting, very specific in the dashboard, you want to take some action immediately. And this action could be created using integration with other systems. So for example, you may email this very specific item to your teammates. So just clicking on the item in Looker to select email to support team, and email will be sent. Set of possible actions, Looker have something pre-built, but also it's possible to use an API to create some custom actions. For example, I saw a case somewhere in YouTube that manager can see in Looker that sales for some product are very low, and most probably because of price, because price is very high. And right here in Looker, he click button, let's make some promotion, some discount for this item. And this action calls some function which changes price in the database. So something like this. User can download result, user can export as PDF, or if the user is interested in the data only, download as CSV. If in the dashboard you have lots of tiles, each tile has oven data, so all the data will be exported as CSV and zip it into one file and send an email. You can schedule то ли scheduling dashboard, so every day at 5 a.m. You will receive new fresh copy of the data. Also, conditional alerts, I think it's similar to other DAI platforms. You are specifying just condition for some metrics, and if this condition met, you will receive notification. So authentication, very short. Possible authentications with G Suite, with Azure Active Directory. They also support two-factor authentication. So different options and plus Looker native authentication when you create just user directly in Looker. Roles, also important part. I will switch to, Roles in Looker are combination of permission set and model set. In Looker platform, you may have lots of projects, lots of models. Access is configured on model, plus you configure feature access for your user. So model set here is example. We have very simple one. Model set could be just single model like this one, or you may specify several models in one model set. And permission set. Default permission sets created by Looker are admin, developer, user, and viewer. So admin has all full access, developer may have limited access to some platform instance-wide settings. User is have access to dashboards, looks, and explore. So a user can use explores for ad hoc queries. And viewer, most limited access just to see predefined dashboards and logs. So role is a combination of permission set plus model set. Okay. And we have very interesting about user attributes and security. User attributes. So you can set up in Looker, even if you have your users integrated with some external authentication system, you can add user attributes on Looker level. There are some default user attributes like email, username. And you may add your custom ones. And these custom ones could be used for role level security. When you create a new attribute, if you suppose to use this attribute for filtering, you need to specify advanced type that will allow you to use multiple values here and special symbol for all values. Also, when you create new user attribute, there are three options possible. User can see this attribute in their profile. User can edit this attribute. or user even doesn't see it. So when you're creating some attribute specifically for security level, user must not be able to edit values there. And I have one I'm using in my test cases, can access country. So default value is this person symbol. It means that all values allowed. And if for someone value will be changed, so that particular values will be applied to the model. And one of the when you see your profile here, these are your attributes actually. It's a specific landing page, most useful for all users. So this is your home page in Looker. This would be a relative link to something on the Looker platform. For me, it is my board. So I always go there. And here you can see that can access country. I can see value, but I cannot edit. And in this case, it can be used for security. And raw object level security. Looker was the first BI platform where I, on my own, saw how object level security could be organized in the data model. So for raw level security, actually for all level security, we use access filter. And for object level security, we use access grants. And I will show. In this project, we have users in the database, users from two countries, UK and US. And in this explore, I have access filter, which is based on that user attribute can access country. So field user country must be equal can access country. And And object level security is defined in the here. I define that user details are sensitive. So email, first name and last name are sensitive and cannot be visible for all of the users. So I can stop here, required access grant, and here is a grant name. Grant name is specified in the model. So access grant can view sensitive data, is based on user attribute email, and allowed values are me and my colleague. So only me and he will be able to query that sensitive information. Also with Looker, it's possible to mask sensitive data. I didn't have such requirements in my projects, but I saw this in examples. So using some hash functions from the database, you can and user attributes again, you can set up and retrieve original value or hashed value. What else? What else? Oh, almost finished. Very interesting, but not covered in this session because lots of Liquid and HTML Invoker. Liquid is a, I don't remember, it's a third party language used for templated parameters, for references. So they just enrich your capabilities in data formatting, data linkage in your model. Also, like in object-oriented programming, you can create some base table and then create extensions with different measure calculations depending on the use case. Looker has API and they said say that it is perfect. Probably, I didn't try. It is possible to embed Looker visualization and Looker pieces in other applications. Looker has extension framework and lots of open source applications using Looker extending capabilities. Also, they have marketplace where you can reuse some pre-existing blocks or pieces of code. Also, imported projects I've already touched. You can reuse on the same platform or external project in GitHub. You can reuse existing project and codes from there without editing. And also you can localize in different languages your models. Whew, that's all.